Our next speaker is a Brazilian native and microbiologist with deep interest in biodiversity and ecosystem functionality of the Amazon rainforest. In order to shed light on these and other microbial ecosystems in question, he uses high-throughput genomic technologies to study microorganism environments as diverse as tropical forests and termite hindguts. Today, he serves as an assistant professor within the Department of Biology at UTA. Please welcome Jorge Rodrigues.
So for the next 10 minutes, I'm going to try to convince you that Dr. Seuss has been lying to you. And I hope that if I convince you of that, what you're going to do is to go back home, buy more Dr. Seuss books, and read to your kids, with your siblings, friends, grandkids, and so on. Why do I say that? Because it's my own experience when I started working in the Amazon. I was really interested in learning more about the Amazon. If I'm going to go there, I want to find out what's there already. And if I'm going to be there, I want to find out if something is going to eat me. Who is going to eat me there, right? So what I did was to collect a whole bunch of information about the Amazon. And I collect books, I collect readings, I collect videos, and I start reading all of this. But the book that really caught my attention was this book. Why is that? Well, because it's all about the rainforest, right? So I said, this is the must-read book for me. If I'm going to go there, I should read more and more about this book. So I start reading this book, and what happened is that the book starts talking about the rainforest and the patterns, the dry seasons and the rainy seasons of the forest. And I said, oh, that's very interesting. Let me continue reading this. The next topic was about the locations. And it told me where the rainforests are located. But I'm a scientist. And as a scientist, I don't just trust data. I really want to find out what's going on with data. So what I did was to connect with people who could tell me more about the Amazon or about the rainforest. So I found one expert. And the expert was 7-year-old. So when I asked him, where are the locations of the rainforest? And he told me, well, rainforests are located in Central and South America. They're also located in Africa in countries like Congo, Zaire, Gabon, Madagascar. And then back again, we have rainforests in countries like the Philippines, Thailand, Malaysia, New Guinea. And I compare the information that the expert gave me with the information that I got from the book. And they both matched, right? So I'm going to start continuing. I'm going to read more and more about this book. The next topic on the book was about the biodiversity. It talks about the biodiversity of plants and biodiversity of animals. And I said, I'm going to get there to the Amazon. It's going to be like a zoo to me because I'm going to see all kinds of animals, all kinds of plants. Turned out that when I got there, that's what I saw. Pretty dark place. And this is the middle of the day, right? And I thought, well, wait a minute. All those books promised me that I would see something else. Actually, the books told me 25% of all terrestrial species are present in the Amazon. 25%. The books told me that in 100 by 100 square meters, I would find more plants than in the entire European continent. Imagine the entire Europe. In 100 by 100, I can see more plants there. In a single tree, I can see 80 different species of ants. And if you multiply this number of insects by the number of plants, what you would find is a staggering number of 42,000 different insects in a hectare of the Amazon. So, if this is not enough for you, the majority of them have not been described. We don't know what they are doing there. And if I want to relate to something that's more, a little bit more related to us, In a single sampling expedition, we're able to find 72 different species of bats. If you're in the US, we have 42 species of bats. In a single expedition, we're able to almost double the number of bat species in the Amazon. I did not see any animals there. And I was still wondering, what's happening? Why I don't see all those animals? And I would be okay with that, not seeing any animal there. But the problem is, the landscape is changing. The Amazon is changing quite fast. This is a satellite picture of the Amazon forest, part of the Amazon forest. Every little orange dot that you see, it's a fire. It's a fire that started to change the land. How do we do that? You remove all the wood, the hardwood, and sell it. Then you slash everything to the ground. Next, let it dry. When the dry season comes, you set everything on fire. And that fire will burn for days and days, sometimes weeks and weeks. Once everything is returned to ashes, you sow with grass and move your cattle in. You have lots and lots of cattle there. So this idea of changing the land from forest to pasture is really changing the biodiversity in the Amazon forest. Why is that? Because this is the most important factor affecting biodiversity losses in the Amazon. It's more important than the CO2 increase. It's more important than climate change. It's the most important man-made alteration going on in tropical systems these days. Just to give you an example, this is the area where we do our sampling in the Amazon. In 1975, it was a sea of green. You would look to the airplane, you only see trees all over the place. In 14 years, that's what we saw. Lots and lots of changes. This is called a fishbone structure of development. You have a road, and in both sides of the road, you have clearing of the land, transforming forest into pasture. The road continues, the road goes on, and you see more changes. So, if the landscape is changing, then all the inhabitants are changing as well. You know that plants and animals will change. You have a forest with hundreds of plants, and then you have one single plant now, a grass species. You have all kinds of animals, all the animals that I didn't see before, and now I have one single species of animal, a cow. But there are lots and lots of microbes there that I don't see, and I know they're there. Those are tiny little microbes. Have here in my hand, 1 gram of soil, a little gram of soil. In this gram of soil, I have 100 million microbes. There are 10,000 species of microbes in this little gram of soil, right? They're all changing. So I'm here today to tell you they're changing as well. Not plants and animals change, but microbes change as well. The research that we do in the Amazon tells us that the microbial communities in the Amazon soil, they're increasing in similarity. What does that mean? It means that the microbes are becoming more and more of the same. They're becoming more and more equal to each other. Genetically, they're becoming more and more similar to each other. Why is that important? Well, I have 2 reasons for you. The first reason is related to the environment. Environments, ecosystems, they provide us some services, and microbes as well. We don't know that on a daily basis, but you have more microbial cells than human cells. In the Amazon, those microbes are responsible for recycling all the nutrients. All the dead carcasses of animals are recycled by microbes. All the leaves that fall from the trees are recycled by microbes. So microbes are responsible for all the biogeochemical cycles. If we're changing those microbes, then those biogeochemical cycles will be altered as well. Now imagine the Amazon that place. It's really large. It's the largest forest terrestrial ecosystem in the world. If this ecosystem is changing, then Earth is changing. That's the first reason. The second reason, it's because microbes are reservoirs of new antibiotics. They're reservoirs of new biotechnological products. And they're reservoir of cancer-fighting drugs. In fact, there are at least 120 prescribed drugs these days. They are provided, they came from the forest. So if we're losing all those microbes, we're losing the opportunity of finding new drugs, finding new antibiotics, finding new biotechnological products. This is a picture that I took in the Amazon, my last trip there. When we're removing wood from the forest, we're not removing only wood, we're removing something with it. I just told you that. The microbes are disappearing. If the microbes are disappearing, we're removing something else. There are genes, those are antibiotics that we're supposed to find. You and me, we're all driving that truck together. You like it or not, you're responsible for driving the truck. So, as a responsible driver, or as a driver, the question for you to ask is, should I step on the gas pedal and really go for it as fast as I can? Or I just should slow down a little bit and find the safest route for me to keep going? Thank you very much.